Can you guide me through that everybody can listen to me properly? Hello.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Thank you so much. So, let's start maybe. Okay. So, it's my pleasure to share some of my knowledge with you guys, and it's been quite a long to see the Pakistani students. Almost 4 years now I am in China, and it's the first time in the last 4 years I'm presenting something to purely the Pakistani students, and it feels very it's really a pleasure for me to present something. And I think you guys are the master students or the PhD students, so I would like to just briefly present the advanced oxidation processes which are used for the wastewater treatment. And as you have already mentioned that I was working as assistant professor in Pakistan from 2017 to 2018. Now I am in China working as a visiting assistant professor in Shenzhou University. This is a very good university. Shenzhou is basically the eastern part of China, near the Hong Kong. This is my email ID. You can see on your screen. You can contact me on this if you are interested in master's program in water treatment or wastewater treatment. So we have the open vacancies for the PhD and the postdocs in our group. So these are some of the learning points we will be discussing in the next 20 or 25 minutes. I will briefly introduce the advanced oxidation processes and then some types of advanced oxidation processes, their relative mechanisms, and some application technologies and recent developments in this one. And most importantly, I will share some future research possibilities in this particular area. And please note that I have been working on the advanced oxidation processes since 2017 when I did my master's from Arid Agriculture University, Rawalpindi. And then I did my PhD from National University of Science and Technology, Islamabad. So during all these periods, I have been working on the advanced oxidation processes. But still, this is a very basic presentation to understand what is actually the advanced oxidation processes. Starting from the definition, advanced oxidation processes are actually the oxidation processes which are involving the generation of hydroxyl radicals. And everybody knows that hydroxyl radicals are very reactive species, and they can degrade a lot of organic pollutants, whatever in air or in water, they are very effective. And if you consider the history of the advanced oxidation processes, actually this was started in 1894 when the tartaric acid was decomposed by the hydrogen peroxide, and that is actually known as the Pantone reaction. And the same technology was reported first time for the potable water treatment in 1980s, early 1980s. And later on, this technology was further applied for the wastewater treatment. And why this was applied to the wastewater treatment? Because the generation of hydroxyl radicals, which is a very strong oxidant, can readily degrade compounds. And these mo compounds mostly include the organic pollutants and relatively less to the inorganic pollutants. And after some time, or more recently, this same concept has been applied to the sulfate radicals. So this is to understand the basic mechanism for the advanced optimization process is, actually what happens, you need at least two things for this technology. One is the initiator, slide that initiator, and what are the initiator? Actually, these are the compounds which are helpful to generate the hydroxyl radicals. And on the other hand, you need a catalyst, basically. And that catalyst could be the metal oxide, some metals, some physical means like the UV, ultrasonic radiation, or semiconductor materials. You need these two things to generate the hydroxyl radicals. And once the hydroxyl radicals are generated, they react with the organic pollutant, undergo number of reactions to ultimately water and the carbon dioxide. And please note that in all of this reaction, you must need the oxygen. Otherwise, you will be incomplete and you cannot get the ultimate product. The hydroxyl radicals have some very good properties. For example, they have a high redox potential of about 2.8 moles, and they are non-selective in nature. They react with any organic pollutants which are present in the water or in aqueous environment or even in the air. And very reactive and rapid reaction. Actually, the downside of these hydroxyl radicals is they are very short-lived. They just work for only the microsecond level, but their production is in situ. In situ means that you are producing within the reactor or within the area where you need to degrade the organic pollutant. So they can readily react with the organic. You can also see from this table that it is of different redox potentials. The hydroxyl radicals are on the top of this one. Let's talk about different types of advanced oxidation processes. Basically, you can categorize advanced oxidation processes based on different things. For example, mode of hydroxyl radical generation, or in this one, and even the application point of view. But here I have just list based on the ozone, electron related, and other may include the ultrasound sounds and electronic beams. And these all are related to the hydroxyl radical based advanced oxidation processes. And there is another one that is a sulfate radical based advanced oxidation processes. But I will be majorly discussing the advanced oxidation processes which are based on the hydroxyl radical. So if you see this slide, you can feel that there are two different mechanisms of the hydroxyl radicals and the sulfate radicals. And they have inherently a different mode of action. So this is like that, for example, if you see the hydroxyl radicals can preferably add carbon carbon double bond, and they can also abstract the hydrogen from the CH bond. If you see the sulfate radicals can only remove the electrons from the organic material, and they can ultimately degrade to carbon dioxide and water. But you need to select these systems based on the requirements. I can say that if you really want to degrade the organic pollutants, you would select hydroxyl-based radicals. But if you want to remove the inorganic contaminants like the ammonia or like other phosphate materials, you need to use the sulfate radicals. Because the hydroxyl radicals are very slow in inorganic materials. They react very slowly with ammonia and other inorganic things. And this is a generalized scheme that if you want to degrade the organic, you should radical. And if you want to work with the inorganic material, you should, which are using a sulfate radical. So this is another way to say the same concept, that you need to have a chemical reagent you need to describe the photocatalytic process, or maybe you can directly dissociate the water into hydroxyl radicals. And these are different schemes you can generate the hydroxyl radicals. But here you feel that your ultimate goal is to generate the hydroxyl radicals, and these hydroxyl radicals are then utilized for next reaction. And again, there is another diagram showing advanced oxidation technologies. You see there are a number of technologies which are being used for the water and the wastewater treatment, and among them UV-TiO2 is the best known and well reported technology, and it's used as water as a source for production of the hydroxyl radicals. And you have also you can see that UV can be coupled with the ozone can be used in combination with the hydrogen peroxide, and even UV with the hydrogen peroxide, and you can see a lot of different combinations, and you can combine even three together, like UV, hydrogen peroxide, and ozone. But the ultimate objective is of all of these is to produce the hydroxyl radical. So it depends on the concentration of your system, the concentration and the quantity of the pollutants in your target wastewater. I will discuss briefly about the UV-TiO2 system, because it's well reported, and you can say that it's a flagship system for advanced oxidation processes. So what happens actually in the UV-based advanced oxidation processes? The hydroxyl radicals can be initiated by photons in the presence of catalyst or oxidant. So like I already said, you need at least two things. One, as a source for the hydroxyl radicals, and second, to excite something. Here, we are using UV to excite our catalyst or oxidant. In this case, I have considered the titanium dioxide TiO2 as a catalyst. And what happens actually when the TiO2 is excited through UV radiation, preferably 254 nanometer, or you can also excite with the 365 nanometer UV, because you can find a lot of different variable UV lights in the market. So anyone less than 360 can be used to excite the TiO2. So when you excite the titanium dioxide, you will find that the electrons from the conduction band goes to the valence band, and there is an electron and hole generated in the conduction band. So what happens, these holes which are in the valence band, they can react with the OH and produce OH radicals. And the same way, it can also react with the water molecules to produce the hydroxyl radicals. On the other hand, the electrons in the conduction band can react with the oxygen, which is adsorbed onto the surface of the catalyst, and they can form the superoxide. And these all species can further react with the your organic material or whatever the material is present in the wastewater, and they can be degraded to their byproduct. And now I will discuss as an example of the photocatalysis, which is a prominent part of the advanced oxidation processes. Before discussing the photocatalysis, I would like to emphasize on this diagram, and this shows electromagnetic spectrum, and this electromagnetic spectrum shows you the relative size, their temperature, and their penetration in the Earth's atmosphere. This is important because you need to understand that we want the available light from the sun to utilize for the oxidation reaction, for specifically for the photocatalytic reaction. But here you can see only of the electromagnetic spectrum near the visible range can surface of the Earth. Other parts are blocked in the atmosphere. Only about 5% of the ultraviolet reach to the surface of the Earth, but mostly we receive the visible light onto the surface. So The main focus of the research these days is to utilize the visible light and activate the catalyst to further perform the oxidation processes. So another basic slide that you need to understand that the only light can degrade most of the molecules with the extended light exposure. These images you have been familiar and you have seen in your daily life that if you put some organic material or a polymer or even a fabric in outside in the sun for a long period of time, you will see the color will fade away. And this is actually happens when the light interacts with the molecules, color fading happens. And there is some changes into the molecular structure of different even colors. And the plastic items become brittle. You can see that if you put a plastic material or polymer material, and this same can be used by the researchers, and this technology has been utilized in water and wastewater treatment systems. And again, another basic concept that is a photocatalysis that is driven light induced reaction. Okay, so you can use the light means photo as a light, and some of the catalyst you can use to excite the catalyst, and then you can for the degradation of target pollutants. And this was reported by a German scientist in 1972 to actually split the water molecules. And you can see that this same one publication has already received more than 22,000 citations. And actually, he is considered as the father of the photocatalysis. After 1972, there is a huge progress in catalysis. And he actually worked on the titanium dioxide. And titanium dioxide is considered as the most efficient photocatalyst for the environmental remediation because it's a cheap. We can discuss a lot about the TiO2, but now I would skip this part and focus on basically the mechanism part of the advanced oxidation process. And this is just an example. Catalyst actually behaves in the same way. Like I have already mentioned that when the light strikes to a titanium dioxide, it excites the electron from the valence band, and the electrons go to the conduction band, and there is that vacancy for the called as a hole, and there is an excited electron in the conduction band. These two things then further react with the water molecules and oxygen, which is absorbed to the, on the surface of this particle, and then these two species, basically the hydroxyl radicals, react with organic pollutants and ultimately goes to water and carbon dioxide. And this is a generalized scheme. The catalyst more or less works in a similar way. So if you consider using this approach, what you need is to synthesize a very good catalyst. And but in the real application for environmental perspective, you cannot use the powder because powder from the aqueous environment is very difficult to recover and reuse. So then you certainly need to immobilize the powder onto a cold material. And there is a significant progress in this area. And my recent volley onto the immobilization. I'm not more concerned on the synthesis part, but I'm more concerned about the immobilization because the chemists have already synthesized a lot of active materials which can be used under the visible light, but the problem is we cannot use that materials at an industrial scale or even at a pilot scale. We need to immobilize them into a certain sport material. But the problem here is if you immobilize that material, the efficiency goes down. So you need to create a balance between the efficiency and ability. So I have been working since last 2 or 3 years on the different materials. So I was working on polyvinyl based systems. And then if you have successfully immobilized this, you can use these materials for the environmental application. And this is actually the membrane bioreactors is a very promising area for the wastewater treatment. And I'm considering to couple the advanced oxidation processes with the membrane bioreactors. And if you see, if you guys are familiar with the membrane, it would be familiar with quenching. And this graph shows you that how quorum quenching is by every year. I'm not going too much about this one because this is a little away from the topic. But I would emphasize here that the membrane biotechnology, your membrane bioreactors, they are being extensively used in the environmental remediation, specifically for the wastewater treatment. But the problem here is the membrane or the biofoil units are expensive and they can be challenging if you need to replace the membrane after every few cycles. Membrane fouling and membrane stability is a question for, and this problem can be tackled using advanced oxidation processes. I will discuss how we can tackle this problem. Consider some literature from the old studies. You can see some people have already mentioned and highlighted that the advanced oxidation process could be a very beneficial system to integrate with the membrane filtration system. And you can see there are some reports which have mentioned about the photolytic quorum quenching, and some also mentioned about catalytic quorum quenching system. But technique is still under investigation at a very small scale, and emphasize on the pilot in a larger scale. So this is another part of the presentation. I would suggest you to focus on this one, because what actually happens here, this is actually a part of my research, and I want you to have a focus on this one. Like I was mentioning that I worked on an immobilization, and I have submitted a patent for this material to construct in which you can immobilize any sort of catalyst and use these beads to organic pollutants in as well as in the air system. So what actually happens, there is a very simple and efficient way to make, and these polymer beads you can use in the suspended form, in the floating form. By controlling their composition, you can make a bead which can float onto the surface of, as well as you can make them so if you want to utilize the sunlight, you can make them as a floating form, and if you want to use your in a batch system or in a reactor, you can make them as a suspended form. File the Chinese patent, and the Chinese patent is accepted. A little about my work. Initially, when I came to China, I worked on the construction of porous beads with a modified polysulfone alginate and immobilized TiO2 as a catalyst for a recyclable photocatalyst for the wastewater treatment. And this was published in 2020. And now, again, the similar concept was applied to another sort of catalyst on the visible light, which is actually the silver phosphate, the TiO2. And in this particular application, we made them in a two different forms, like in the floating form and in the suspended form. So you can switch the mode of your catalyst depending on the nature of your application. And more recently, I would like you to that I have worked on the photocatalytic quorum quenching, and this is actually a new concept I have introduced recently in 2000, that the photocatalytic, again, you see that it's the advanced oxidation processes which can be combined with the membrane bioreactors. And this membrane bioreactor was coupled to the UASB. And we can certainly use this system to improve the wastewater quality as well as we can improve the hauling of the membrane. But the problem of these systems is that these systems cannot be used in the polymer-based membrane. And if you guys are familiar with the membrane system, most of the membranes are made of the polymers, like polysulfone or PES or PVDF, or like these sort of. And these polymers actually are prone to degradation by the hydroxyl radicals and other reactive species generated due to the photocatalytic system. But we can improve this one by adding the ceramic membranes. And this is the recent work I'm doing, and this is not published yet. The manuscript is ready, but I still need to wait for the final publication. And in this study, we have used the ceramic membranes instead of the polymeric membranes, because the ceramic membranes are very robust, and they can withstand a very high pressure and the harsh environmental conditions. And they are resistant against the hydroxyl radicals and other radicals generated through this one. So in this particular study, I have combined the UV and the ozone for hauling control and color removal from the real textile wastewater. And the results are very, very encouraging, and we are hopeful to share these results soon. And actually, you can see that if you use the UV lamps and use the ozone, you can generate a large amount of hydroxyl radicals and the nascent oxygen. And these two, nascent oxygen and hydroxyl radicals, in turn can react with the different organic molecules as well as with the bacteria to degrade and ultimately control the biofouling, as well as you can improve the water quality. So you can see from this, this is just a representative results from my unpublished data. And you can see from this is a TMP profile of different reactors. And if you see the graph B, you can see that the UV and ozone in combination is relatively better if you use in the, so if 15-15 means that the intermittent 15 minutes on and 15 minutes off. And if you see at this level, the second last bar, you can see that it's much better than the zone and UV on the intermittent form. But if you see the only UV is very, very efficient, but is also the very energy intensive system. The only UV can be used for the treatment as well as for the biofouling control, but it's very energy intensive, and you cannot continuously use the UV because the UV lamps have a certain life and you need to replace them. So you also need to give them a time for the cooling. So the intermittent UV is preferred compared to the continuous UV. But still, if you use the UV with the ozone, you can have a significantly improved efficiency as well as the fouling control. So this is the maybe the future aspect. And this is the direction I would suggest to work on this one. And there is not a lot of work done on the UV and ozone combined form in the membrane bioreactor, specifically related to the polymeric membrane, because this system is very dangerous for the polymeric systems, polymeric membranes, because the hydroxyl radicals or the other radicals which are being produced through this system, they can degrade your membrane, and you need to change the membrane after a certain time. So, but if you consider the ceramic membrane, this system is special for the ceramic membrane. All from my side to answer a few of your questions if you have any.
Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable time. It was a great session. Now, everyone, if you have any question, you can write in the chat box. So that's how we'll answer that question. I think that there's no any questions. So, sir, we can wind up the meeting. Thank you so much again for your time, for the session. It was great. We learned a lot from your information. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much for inviting me. One last thing to mention again. If somebody wants to apply for the PhD or a postdoc position in the wastewater treatment system, so please you can contact and ask them to contact me if they have CVs for